A very good afternoon to one and all. I'm Ankita Chauhan from NASSCOM, and I have with me my colleague Anish Sharma. We are back with another interesting session under our product management series, and today we have Nitin Arora, product owner for cloud-based solution in SAP. He will share his knowledge and experience on the topic Agile execution, crafting user stories, backlogs. You can write your questions anytime during the session, and the answers to most of them will be given at the end of the presentation, depending on the time we are left with. Plus, don't forget to give your feedback so that we can improve our future sessions. Over to you, Nitin.
Thanks, Ankita. So today's, before I start, am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, Nitin.
Great. So today's topic is product management, agile execution, where we'll be talking about crafting user stories and backlogs. So before we start, a short introduction. I'm Nitin Arora. I'm currently working as a product owner of a cloud-based solution in SAP. And with about 12 plus years of experience in software industry and MBA in product leadership, I'm passionate to build new products. Initially, I started my career as a software developer, then solution consultant. I've also worked closely with a pre-sales team and finally transitioned to product management. So it has been a couple of years working in product management space and Agile. And I'm privileged today to talk about this topic on Agile user stories and backlog. So let's learn together. So coming directly to our topic, what is Agile? So if you'll search in the internet from the definition that has been given. So this is a quote I have taken from Jim Highsmith. He's from Agile Software Development Ecosystem. What he talks about is agility is the ability to both create and respond to change in order to profit in the turbulent business environment. So in sense, agility is like you have to be agile. You have to respond to the changing environment, and end result is we want to be profitable in the turbulent business environment. So whatever the condition or situation is, business has to be profitable, and we have to respond as per the changing needs. So somewhere to give a brief background about Agile, how it all started. Somewhere around in 2001, there were 17 people who met from the different background. And this is where they came up with the Agile Manifesto. But the main core values that came out of Agile Manifesto is individuals and interactions over process and tools. And we want working software over comprehensive documentation, more on customer collaboration over contract negotiation, and responding to change over following a plan. So what does it mean is if you're following these four values, I can say we are following Agile, because during that meet there were 12 design principles that were being laid out where they talked about highest priority to customer satisfaction by early and continuous deliverables, welcome changing requirements, and working on the deliver working software frequently. And likewise, business people and developer must work together. So I have given a hyperlink over here, what all principles and values it talks about. Crux of this is if we are following these values and principle, then I can say we are following Agile. So first question that comes around is, what's the need of Agile? So are we living in a agile world? So if we talk about software development, I have been seeing software development in my somewhere starting from 2005. And what we studied during our engineering, like waterfall model, spiral model, and how different phases goes through like design, implementation, delivery. So still are we in the same model where certain projects goes on and on for years and requirements are being captured in the beginning, and after a couple of years a final deliverable is there? Can we still live with that situation, or we have to react to the changing market need? We have to be more adaptable and there should be a time to market, because if something is needed now, 3 years down the line, or 6 years, or let's say even 6 months down the line, situation would have changed. And by the time we are developing, others are also developing. And what customer need today, they might not need tomorrow. So in that way, we have to be agile enough to meet the customer requirement and to meet the customer need. And with all the new technologies coming in, like we might have heard of machine learning, artificial intelligence. So if you're building certain solutions, so if I'm bringing my solution out in 3 years down the line, taking requirements today, will these technologies and the solution or the value we are developing would remain same? So it's a big question. So that's the reason you're talking about, with the changing pace, with the changing time, with the changing requirement and changing need, we have to be agile enough. So anytime when people talk about agile, they directly relate to Scrum. So as we mentioned earlier, agile has core values and principle. I would say anything that fit in this umbrella is following agile. There are certain defined processes and framework to follow agile. To name it, like in software industry, you would see a lot of people follow Scrum. And there are other methodologies also which fit under agile, like extreme programming, feature-driven development, and Crystal, DSTM, which is dynamic system development method. So main aim is meeting customer requirement, time to market, have agility enough to address it, then we can say we are following agile. We'll deep dive further in Scrum, because most of the projects, at least what I have seen, is if they are saying they are agile, they are following Scrum. Reason is it gives a defined framework, defined roles, what need to be done. And then while you have a team which is being formed, then you can follow a hybrid model also. Like nowadays, I've been hearing people who are following Scrum have Kanban also. They make use of Kanban board. So let's discuss this in detail, what all Scrum team is, and when you're following Scrum, what are the best practices? Then we can move to the topics of user stories, backlogs, how to write good user stories, how to create a value out of it. And our end goal is delivering the value to the customer, capturing the feedback, and how to improvise. So typically in a Scrum team, when you say we are working in this Scrum model, the team size varies from 5 to 8. Best practices is, or Scrum can be followed best is if a team is co-located, but it doesn't mean if it's geographically, team members are located in different places, we cannot follow Scrum, we can still follow Scrum. And even it doesn't mean if team member size is more than 8, we are not following Scrum. But these are guidelines. Reason is because when it comes to Scrum, we have daily stand-ups, which is about 10 to 15 minutes. If a team size is more, you cannot have this sync meeting, which can be completed in 10 to 15 minutes. So if I talk about the roles, there's a product owner. In the market, if you talk about in the product management space, there are different terminologies and notions coming out. In certain companies, there are product owner. In certain companies, there are product manager. And some have both product owner and product manager. So I would say a person who is defining the vision, working on the product, how the product should be, with a product mindset, is a product person. Then coming to this terminology, someone who is internal facing, coordinating with a team, product owner. If certain companies are people who are outward facing, talking to the customers, stakeholders, taking the requirement, translating it back to the team, they are product manager. And they, in certain companies, they are one person playing all the roles. But intent is how you're contributing for the product vision. So in this typical setup, a Scrum Master is responsible for how this Scrum should go to unblock the team, what team needs, product owner gives a requirement, and dev team works. So if I'm seeing dev team, they are not only the developers, it's a team who is responsible to deliver a product feature, which include, there could be UX team members, there can be KM who writes a document, and these developer would be testing their product also. There could be dedicated quality engineers also in this team. And whenever we talk about requirements, question comes, who is responsible for the product requirements? Because these product requirement could come through various channel, could can directly come from customers, could come from stakeholder, could come from the same vertical based on the business need, business goals, and certain requirement could be like a value add, which even team could suggest. If we'll do this specific thing, they will add a value to the product and it would be great. But end of the day, product owner is responsible for managing all these requirements. So as I said, so product owner is responsible for the requirement, but this doesn't limit to only him working on the requirement, because anytime a new feature is being planned, product owner has to work closely, collaborate with the stakeholders, collaborate with the dev team, have to come back and then keep on refining the requirements. And couple of times dev team can directly or stakeholder can directly create a requirement, but further refining it, product owner has to get involved. Reason for this refinement is whenever these requirements are coming to the team, when the sprint is starting, it should be crystal clear. So if somebody is following Scrum, so Scrum has this iterations, which is called sprint, and it usually lasts for 3 to 4 weeks. So when these requirements are coming and picked in the sprint, it should be clear enough for the developers to pick it and start working. As we talked about sprint, we'll spend 2-3 minutes over here, because still it is debatable what should be a duration of a sprint. Because some people say if we are agile enough and if we want to go out market soon, even the 4 weeks is too long time for a feature to be developed and have to take into a production. So it depends on case to case basis, business need, the space we are working in. Some team are comfortable enough based on the requirements that are coming in, it can be done, or value can be created within 3 weeks. So they are quite comfortable in following a 3 week sprint. But anything less than 2 week, it's tough to follow that, because by the time you go in the design phase, you understand the requirement, you have a prototyping, sketch ready, people working over there. 2 weeks is slightly a difficult time where we can say a feature could be developed and ready. And as we are talking about sprint, Scrum, now usually a question that comes and I have seen people discussing around is Scrum a single silver bullet which can be implemented and used in all the projects? So again, it depends on the business need and case to case basis. So what if there's a project which is a completely a maintenance project? And in that case, if you're saying we want to be agile and we want to follow Scrum, 4 week Scrum, it won't work out. Because in the maintenance project, if you're working on ticketing system, let's say L1, L2 or L3 supports, it has a SLA associated to it. So I can, or a team member cannot say currently I'm working on some certain things, even if a high critical issue comes, I won't pick it. But still they can be agile. There's a way to follow this agile methodology. They can make use of Kanban and certain other flavors which will help them to deliver faster, respond quickly, and still they'll be agile. Now, coming to a definition of ready backlog or prioritized backlogs. So usually what happened, product owner spent quite a lot of time in requirements. So if I'm saying a requirement, it doesn't mean a product owner has to involve full time dedicatedly writing stories or writing backlogs. And okay, there are various tools to do that. For example, Jira could be used to write these backlogs and use a story, but that's not the only primary thing which he has to do, because even to write those requirements or to translate them to backlog and use a story, product owner should have a complete insight of a problem, what they're trying to solve, and the solution which will come out of this requirement, whether it really fits for this problem or not. So that's the reason, along with this requirement discussion, they have to closely collaborate with the stakeholders, with the dev team, to see if these things can be addressed and can be worked on. So I would say requirement gathering or requirement writing or backlog or story creation is not a one-time process, it's an iterative process. It could happen if we are working in a four-week sprint model. Today, I am writing a backlog or a requirement for 4 months ahead. Like this being September, I may be working on the backlogs, which my team will pick in the month of December on the Q1 of 2019. Because it itself need time for the refinement, whether this is the right thing which can be addressed in the timely fashion or not. But when that sprint starts, so let's say if a sprint is starting by next week, so expectation is product owner has to prioritize these backlogs. So this is a role of a product owner. He has to prioritize these backlogs, which can be picked by the team, and these backlog should be ready to be picked by the team, and that's the reason it becomes a sprint backlog, because team in that specific sprint would be working on these specific requirements. So we have heard of user stories, like product owner usually spend time on writing user stories, and if you'll see a typical trend, it goes like, as a type of user or a persona, I want to have some feature so that some goal can be achieved. So typically when people write user stories, they follow this template, like as a persona or as a user, I want to do this action so that goal can be performed. But a lot of times we have seen when the story is being written, value that comes out in so that part get missed. So that's the important section where most of the time product owner should spend the time. Reason is, if some feature is being developed, but what value and impact it's creating for the end user who is using that feature should be clear to be product owner, and finally should get translated further to the team. Because product owner may have a big picture, and once he's writing a story, if he's not translating that big picture into a story with a value part, and once during grooming this story going to a developer, then developer would see only this user story and would miss the value part. And once he'll see, that's a realistic things we have been seeing when developers work on this, then they would say, this has been defined and my software works according to it. So that's the reason it's needed. Most of the time should be spent on what a value a story is create, this story would be creating. So while writing user stories, how you would say that user story is complete? We discussed that writing a user story or responsibility of the user stories with the product owner, but to what details user story capture all aspects so that one is going to development team, they understand what we are trying to achieve and everything is clear in that aspect. So in that way, what product owner has to focus is mainly on acceptance criteria, what's the scope and what's the detail, because we can define a one-liner like as a persona, the action the persona is doing, so that what the goal they are trying to achieve. But underlying, there could be certain dependencies, there could be various scenarios. Example is, let's say let's take example of any marketplace, like say Amazon or Flipkart. If a user is coming in and if they're trying to browse for a content, at that time they're able to search the content, they have not logged in. So scenario, what user should be able to do when he's not logged in, and scenario when he is able to log in. Secondly, what's the acceptance criteria? Acceptance criteria, first for sure, is the functionality should work. So in that case, if you're saying functionality is working, let's say I want to shop for certain content in marketplace, I'm able to place an order. But what if the placing order itself is taking 5 to 7 seconds? So that's the reason when you're talking about acceptance criteria, done criteria should also be mentioned over there. Say, what's the performance standard? What's the KPI? So if a user is doing certain transactions, what's the KPI in which it's expected to give the result? If user is trying to search for products in Amazon's, so what's the KPI? So within how many seconds he should be able to see all the content? If user is trying to buy for a content, so what's the KPI? Secondly, coming to security. So the transactions that are being done, so is it secure? Is it meeting our all performance and security standard? So is it like while writing, while developing those stories, by mistake, developers has not given a room so that bug can be injected, or is there any security loophole? So those all things should be taken care for the story. So usual practices when we say about done criteria, let's say performance, security, so these become a standard template for all the backlogs and the user stories, so that any developers who are working for these stories as a part of acceptance criteria along with the functionality, KPI is being considered, security checks have been run, there are enough quality coverage over there, enough Q1, Q2 being written. So these becomes a template in addition to the functionality that user story will provide. So as we talked about user story, who is primarily writing this user story? So if there is a new requirement, so which based on various interaction of product owner with the stakeholder and developers and the users, if he's privileged, like it's a B2B product, then product owners are privileged to get a direct feedback. If it's B2C, there are ways to get the feedback. We'll cover them later, but point is, out of all these situation, product owner has identified certain pain points which can be addressed and which to certain extent has been validated with the stakeholder, what value it can create if we address these pain points. Product owner can start writing these stories. And once product owner is taking these stories to the team, along with the team discussion, it's being identified that this is not a single story. Like it cannot be done quite easily. It itself can break into multiple stories. So usually the boundaries that we keep is story is to that granular level so that it can be delivered in one tact. If it can be further split into multiple tasks or multiple stories, then it's a contender for epic. So when we usually decide whether story is a story or a big story which fits under epic umbrella. So as I said, when product owner is working on the stories beforehand, he know how much time it will take. For example, in a marketplace to place an order. To place an order, there are multiple tasks that has to be done. Content has to be discovered, if content is there, about authentication, authorization, and then while placing order, there's a payment gateway which has to be indicated. There are a couple of things around. So here, user, a product owner knows it itself is a big story. It can break down into multiple stories, but when they are bringing this into a team discussion, then team might identify. So you are talking about this transaction, or you're talking about this authentication, there can be multiple type of authentication. So there can be basic auth, there can be auth. So in that way, we can split this in two. So based on the authentication type. So these discussion helps to break down these stories into multiple stories and fit it into a epic umbrella. So likewise, once that is done, now we can clearly identify the users who will be working on this, and with this clear stories being marked, I can, or a product owner can communicate back to the stakeholder when is which story coming out of this sprint and what has been planned. So it helps in planning, it helps in commitment, and it helps in deliverables. Now, an interesting thing, what I have seen in the past, so people when start writing user stories, or what they usually do whenever a requirement come, any backlog or any requirement, they used to write it as a user story. So backlog or requirement, not everything can be translated to user stories. To give you an example, let's say if landing page performance is bad. So I have seen people writing something like, as a user, when I'm launching XYZ application, page should get loaded within 2 seconds to give Uber experience. Because there they want to translate this back to user story, which is not needed. Because end of the day, product requirement has to be captured, which should be simplistic. So something which is simple enough as, or can be translated to the team, is landing page performance has to be improved. So here I don't have to identify a persona. If I am as a user coming in, or I am as a product owner coming in, or as a customer coming in, because the landing page performance will remain same for everyone. So if I'm coming to a marketplace, the way the landing page or home page is loading, and I'm seeing a categories of all the products being available, would be same for everyone. So in that case, let's keep the thing simple. So if, next question that comes in mind is, if all backlog is not translated to user stories, what are backlogs, how they can be written, and what's the criteria to write the backlogs? So as we have seen, user story is also a backlog. A backlog can be simple enough as example which I gave of landing page performance. Backlog can be for infrastructure tasks, like where dev team is asking, we have to provision additional machine for our performance landscape because team is investing over there. My sprint investment is going over there. So one backlog can be created for infrastructure task. And on the similar line, if team has delivered a feature in the past and they're feeling we are seeing certain CSNs in this area, it might need code refactoring, which would be good for futuristic maintainability. Then there can be a backlog for code refactoring. And likewise, if there's a new topic where team has to start working in, where they don't have much clue about, reason could be various, because that's a new space, new technology, then they might say, we want to take this investment in the POC mode, and based on that, we'll productize. So backlog generically is any investments which are done for the product and which is further communicated to the team. So not like everything has to come in the form of user stories. Now, once backlog has been written, so is backlog refined enough that developer can start working on this. So as I was talking, like writing backlog is an iterative process. It cannot happen in a day. I can write a backlog and team can directly start working over it. Because when we are writing backlogs, or a product owner is writing a backlog, or let's say a product owner is getting a backlog from a stakeholder, he has to spend time over there, and couple of times they have to do combined brain thinking whether certain thing is feasible or not. They have to go back to the stakeholder to get it verified, as and when with multiple discussions, collaboration, this backlog get refined. And in time, when product owner take this back to the team, team come up with some questions. For example, I was talking about authentication mechanism. Let's say a requirement has come for authentication mechanism and team is coming back. What type of authentication mechanism? Is it only basic auth or auth? Then those clarity detail enough is needed when product owner is talking to both stakeholder, dev team. In between, product owner has to start a discussion with the architects also about the feasibility, because when their backlog is being created, what's the intent? We want to deliver certain feature to the customer, but in the timely way it could be done or not. So to get those clarity, this further collaboration and close working is needed. So once these backlog gets refined, then they are contender for to be picked up based on priorities, and these backlogs are shared per sprint wise, where dev team could start working on it. So usually how the backlog creation process happens, so I can share my experience how I am doing. Let's say if you're working in the existing product and you want to penetrate with the new features, then your approach would be different. If you're starting a new product in the new space, in that way, your approach would be different. So let's take a example of if it's about new feature for the existing product. So in that way, I want to create a value by delivering new feature in the product so that I can penetrate well in the market. Take the example of marketplaces. There are a couple of players working in the market. What's a new feature which is different from the other competitors, and what value it will create, and what's the problem area it's addressing which could delight the end user. So for this, a hypothesis has been done and now it needs an early validation. So early validation again depends on whether you're operating in B2B or B2C, because if it's B2B, then directly you can reach to your customers and can talk about, this is what we have identified. If we'll provide solution for these things, will it add value or will it simplify your work? And this can even be done by prototyping. There, like a product owner could use this low fidelity wireframes and go back for the early validation. Why this phase is needed is, until and unless validation is done, what is really needed by my customer or would be used by the end user, the whole investment which is done on this feature would not create any value. So the right hand side, where hypothesis, early validation, prototype and validation, this forms a basic of creating backlogs. And if you are working in B2C space, we are not privileged to get or to validate it or to directly talk to the end user or the customer, but there are various ways to validate the hypothesis. So there can be surveys, there can be primary research, secondary research, with the usage behavior, how the people or customer is using a product. That insight you can get through data analytics. So that's completely a different space of data-driven product management, a product building, where in B2C space, you're not directly interacting with the users, but based on their usage pattern, based on analytics, you're planning new features, you're planning new investment. And once a new investment is done, how that feature is being used by the user, how to capture the feedback, when you're seeing the spike being coming, accordingly planning the new feature. So it is planned that way. So what is needed is, irrespective of the industry, irrespective of the space, irrespective of the model, whether it's B2C or B2B, from hypothesis to validation is needed before you are even taking it to the team. During this phase, you may interact with the team, because let's say a requirement is, I have to create, let's say I have to provide a smart search. So I can have early validation, what's the advantage of giving a smart search? I can create low fidelity wireframes, get it validated. In case of B2B, directly I'm talking to people. But whether it can be implemented, feasible, at least for that, I need to go back to my dev team or to architects. I have to start the discussion. Then architect could say, this goes in the similar line. We have to do POC, but this seems promisable and doable. So let's go ahead with that. And then again, when we are creating backlogs, then we may be marking it as a POC where team need to invest. And based on that POC outcome, team will tell when it can be productized. And similarly, the same timelines can be communicated back to the stakeholders or back to the customer when this feature is coming out based on the POC outcome. So typical scenario when product owner writes a requirement. So I'm generalizing it as a requirement. So I'm not saying it is a user story, infrastructure task, POC or backlog, but from product requirement point of view. So product owner usually works on the requirement. They have worked on bunch of requirement and they need it urgently for next sprint. If you're saying urgently, they would have bucketed what can be done like with a guesstimate based on team velocity, what has been delivered in the past. This is what I'm looking at. And this is what my customer would need it. And then they take it to sprint planning. Couple of times we see, if let's say five requirements are coming, team may reject couple of requirements and only two requirements team will pick. So again, it goes to catch 22 situation, whose problem is this? So whether backlogs or the requirements were not defined properly, has it not been detailed out, a team has not understand it. Because if we are facing this situation, or if we are in the big space, it's a problem for a product. It's a problem for all these roles who are playing in. And end of the day, product is suffering, or the end user for whom you are building the product is suffering. So a couple of times we have seen a discussion where product owners would say everything is being detailed out, and devs may say, no, we need more clarity. So how to solve this problem? So I've tried to explain, if we go in three phases, let's say pre-grooming, grooming, and post-grooming, then we can simplify the process. What does it mean? Whenever you have the requirements, so as a product owner, we are working on the requirements, let's say, which would be delivered after 4 or 5 months. When we are refining it, only solution is collaborate, communicate. As much we collaborate and communicate, we'll keep on refining it. So once backlog we are saying is refined, is good to go, never ever take the requirement directly at the beginning of the sprint to the team, because chances are that time you may uncover certain things which need to be clarified, which could be as small as, based on architectural design, your UI screen or mock won't fit in, or based on UI screen, arc design won't fit in. But again, it needs a discussion. So what recommended best practices? Let's say if I have to plan for next sprint, so this sprint itself, you should have a pre-grooming meeting. So what does it mean is, with the refined state of backlog, prioritize in the order in which we want team to work and deliver, we'll initiate a discussion with the team. So that time, team is much more in the context of what they have to deliver next sprint. Is there any dependencies in the story? So product owner would have worked by this time. If they are dependent story, he would have marked, but he might have missed how to identify. So during this discussion, we can uncover all these gaps, or let's say team is still looking for certain clarifications, or team needs certain time to think over this story from architecture feasibility point of view, whether it is possible or not. So this pre-grooming meeting helps in setting a stepping stone to deliver next tuck or next sprint stories faster. So by the time you're coming for the grooming meeting, you already had one level of discussion for whatever open points. By this time, product owner would go back, collaborate with various entities, get all the inputs needed for. By that time, any technical questions or technical clarity that is needed, architect would also have worked on that. Somewhere where we have to find a middle path, how things can be done, would have resolved. In the grooming meeting, again, we'll meet. We'll address those concerns, address those queries, go again to the topic and discuss these stories. So ideally, this is a meeting where everything should get clarified. So once we are coming for post-grooming is like a planning meeting or a sprint planning. When a sprint planning is happening, at this point, if anything is unclear, but before that, we already had two phases. So expectation is 95 to 98% of the things would have been clarified. Still for 1 or 2%, because again, if we want to discuss again, certain topics can be addressed, but this meeting or sprint planning should be treated itself as a sprint planning. But product owner can clarify if certain thing is still missed out. So if we'll follow this way, this process, then it ensures the previous state, what we were talking about, could be avoided. And we can streamline the requirement, streamline the commitment, streamline the delivery, and streamline the value that we are creating in the product to be used by the end user. So it doesn't complete over here. So once team has developed it, delivered it, now we have to close this loop back, have to get the feedback from the end users. Again, if it is B2C space, based on data-driven analytics, the feature that has been delivered, how the users are consuming it, whether user is able to know about of this feature which is available in the web page. So that data analytics will bring the insight which product owner can capture it, take it back to the team, what's the impact that has been created of the feature that is delivered. Because couple of times there's a learning which we get over here. Let's say a feature has been developed, it is available in my web page, and if we'll see analytics data, people are not even clicking it. So that means it's getting missed out. So that's the time we have to work along with the UX so that the visibility of that feature can be increased. So that again, that's an iterative process that again can come as a backlog, how to reposition it or how to re-message it so that that impact is being created. Yeah, that's all from my side, based on my experience, what I have learned. So if you have any questions around this topic, we could address it.
Yeah, hi Nitin, thank you so much for this great presentation. We have few handful of questions and they are coming up now. So the first one is by Vivek. So he's asking two questions. One is, what do you think about which features are lacking in Jira tool?
So again, I would say these tools and processes are being given, which will help you to deliver product features. So even if you are not using Jira tool or let's say storyboard, but still if you are able to manage thing in your Excel and you are able to maintain your product backlog, translate it to the team, deliver it to the customers on the end user, tool doesn't matter.
All right, I guess it answers Vivek's question. The next is by Aruna. She's asking that what is the best approach to fit in technical debt user stories along with business requirements?
Sorry, Ankita, can you repeat your question?
Yeah, sure. What is the best approach to fit in technical debt user stories along with business requirements?
Okay, then again, it depends on prioritization. So let's say there are certain technical debts which had to be addressed and dev team has been asking if we'll address it, it will create a value. At the same time, always and always product owners are in a pressure of delivering maximum new feature. So certain sprints, they have to see what the trade-off can be done. So in spite of delivering three new features, if we are delivering two new features and addressing the technical debt, which will improve the productivity of the team, and in futuristic, it could reduce CSNs, then as a product owner, I will prioritize it.
All right. The other next question is by Satendra. He's asking that how to define user story for a feature which requires R&D and exploring by developer and assignment of time to those.
Okay, so first of all, I'll split it into two parts. So I would say as the product owner, I'm planning a new feature which would create a value. So from product owner point of view or from the requirement point of view, I should be very clear what I want to achieve, not from technical implementation, but example, I gave it as a smart search. But let's say if I'm going in a marketplace and I am trying to search with certain keywords, my expectation is these results should come in. So this requirement has been given to the team. So when team is seeing that requirement, so then they are realizing this smart search may need some underlying technology, could be Lucene, could be Elasticsearch, which we don't have experience. Then team, when product owner is explaining this requirement, then team can discuss with the team because there's a strong collaboration, communication happening. Prior to the sprint start, they can say, this being a new topic, first we need a research spike, how this Elasticsearch work. So let's invest in this. Based on the outcome of that Elasticsearch, we'll work on the productization. So the very first story would be going in the research spike where team members would be further exploring this technology. So based on the outcome, so let's say in a sprint, they are able to complete it. Team will get a confidence. Now we know, now we understand smart search. Now we understand the underlying open source technology, which we have already finalized to use it after analyzing 2-3 open source or the licensed product which are available, then it can go for productization. But the underlying core value, what we want to deliver, product owner should be clear from the day one, which should be irrespective of the technology which is used. Hope that answers the question. So there's a big answer to this short question.
All right, even I guess so, it answers Satendra's question. The other one is by Krishna. He's saying that what are the minute variations between the product owner and the Scrum Master?
So these roles has been come from Scrum. So we say product owner is the one who will take care of the product requirement. And Scrum Master is the one who will coordinate how the Scrum will go. For example, if a team is getting blocked due to certain infrastructure issue or landscape issue, it's Scrum Master who will help them. Scrum Master will organize daily Scrum meetings, would manage how the stories are being progressed. They will help to speed up the team and will try to shield them from all the external factors which could block them in developing or working for the product.
All right. The next question is by Rohit. He's saying that who decide it's a EPIC or a user story, PO or developer?
Great question, I would say. First of all, when PO is bringing this story to the developer, so he would have put his thought around this, whether this is a small item or a big ticket item. So before bringing this to developers, PO should put a best effort to identify what all is needed. And that is happening while discussing with the developer stakeholder. But when they are coming to a meeting discussing, finally, developer is the one who has to implement that story. So during the discussion, when developer is identifying certain use cases which might have been missed, a classic example which I was giving during the presentation was authentication type, which product owner might not have thought of. And that time, with a mutual agreement, they can break this into multiple stories, and then team can start picking into it. Because at that point, they are identifying what we thought is a single story is actually epic, because there are multiple stories within this.
All right. Thank you. Now the next question is by Shweta. She's saying, how does estimation work out in Agile space?
If I'll go with the specifically for Scrum, so if you talk about story estimation, team usually have this poker card where they give story points. They have discussion on what's the complexity of the story. So they usually take one a reference story. So reference story, let's say, would have done with 2 points. So based on the reference story, what's the complication? Then they have this poker card thing where they individual team members tell what's the complexity of this, and based on that, story point is being assigned. So this helps in estimating the story, because it should not happen once the story is being picked and we are giving a commitment, it will be done. It could be quite complex. If it is quite complex, we are saying more story point has been given. So that itself is an indication this story can further be break down into multiple story, because idea of story is it should get delivered within a sprint. If let's say a story is coming with a story point of 9, where we are saying a reference is as base 2, then again team can sit together and see how they can simplify break down into multiple story or task. So then it can be further estimated, and iteratively it can be done.
All right. The next question is how to handle acceptance criteria updates during the story development.
And who asked this question? Maybe can they be more precise?
Then we got to wait, Nitin, because this was, they are writing the questions. So let's just wait. It was asked by Vardhan Gupta. So let's just wait if in case he writes me back again. So let's just take up the next question, which is how to manage time for pre-grooming, grooming, and post-grooming meetings while sprints are also running?
That's a tough task, to be honest. But it is needed, because if what product owner and team has to think of, they have to be futuristic. I know team is super busy in delivering current sprint activities or deliverables, but at the same time, we have to think of what next, what is in next sprint. So with practice, because initially even we face this issue, but if you'll do in a time bucket way, let's say if it's a 4-week sprint and we say every third week we'll have a pre-grooming. So couple of time it could happen, it gets shifts from Monday to Tuesday, but you have to ensure third week you have to do pre-grooming, then you can channelize.
Okay. The next question is, will I require a agile methodology for small projects with 3 months maximum development time?
So as I said, agile is giving a core values and principle. So it's not mandate. I have to use certain process or framework like Scrum or Kanban. We have to see what all best practices can be taken, because agile is more of like a mindset. Because if I'm seeing within 3 months, I have to deliver with 3 or 5 resources and I could reach directly to the customer, then I can start interacting as a team with a customer quite frequently, can do certain low fidelity prototype, get it validated, can deliver a small piece of feature, give it internally. We can organize a team, whoever is available, they can pick the task and can start moving it from which is not picked to progress to done. So if you're doing everything in turn, we are taking flavors of all these. For example, internally we have been following Kanban because we are taking these items in that way. Extreme programming, where it says major interactions with the customers, with a limited team, shorter span of project. So anytime, if mindset is customer first, product has to be delivered, follow best practices, then we are agile. Because today we are talking about Scrum, XP, Kanban, Crystal. Tomorrow something else may come, but the base fundamental and principles remain same.
Okay. The next question is, for offline negative scenarios, should we write new user story or can we can use the same original story?
User stories always tell what value would be created. Let's say as a persona, if I am doing certain action, what value is created? So expectation is all negative scenarios would have been covered with that. So it could be a part of an acceptance criteria. Because let's say if a user has to log in to do a purchase of a product, so I won't be creating a separate user story of user is trying to log in and login field. So it is expected the negative scenarios to be a part of the value that is being created.
All right. The next question is by Amit. He's asking that in one user story, how many acceptance criteria should be there? Any limitation on number of acceptance criteria?
I would say no limit. Reason is the more detail we are going in acceptance criteria, the more effort or time product owner is spending on defining acceptance criteria, it will bring more clarity to the developers. Because the same example I gave for the negative scenario, in the acceptance criteria, I'm writing for this value is being created. What's the acceptance criteria? What can be a negative scenario? What to be considered? So it enriches that user story or backlog and provide a great vision to people who are working in, so that they can also consider all these aspects.
All right. Then the next question is, any story writing template can you share?
Story writing, if you ask me, just go to Google and everywhere it will tell about each and every link. But usually a best practice is, as a persona, what you are doing, what feature you're trying to use, and what value it's creating. It's similar to the slide what I shared. So it should be more oriented on user, as a user, what action they are doing, and what value would be coming out of that. Yeah, that's a standard thing that's being followed.
All right. Okay, the next question is, how to handle efforts for high priority production issues in between the active sprint?
Great question, I would say. Reason is, couple of times I have seen people talking about, we are following Agile, we are following Scrum. So something which is picked at the beginning of the sprint. What if a high CSN comes or production issue come? How to cater it? Because we are agile, we are Scrum, something being committed after 1 month time, should we pick it or should it be addressed? So best practices would be agile core values, principles, customer first, adaptable to change. But it's not like a whole big story is coming during beginning of the sprint. So whenever a planning happens, sprint planning happens, usually it's advisable to reserve some capacity for any CSNs coming in, so that without impacting the deliverables which are being committed, CSNs can be addressed. So these production issues fall in this bucket. But let's say there is a serious production issue which is taking a couple of days, might be impacting sprint deliverable, then we have to do a trade-off, because at the time which is already available in a production needs more priority to get it fixed.
All right, there are many more questions, but I guess looking at the time, we now need to wind up. So I guess that was the last question. And one more thing, I just want to announce that tomorrow we have a webinar from 12 to 1 on why your business needs a digital transformation. You can register for the same by logging onto the NASSCOM homepage and clicking on the first banner on the masthead area. And Nitin, thank you so much for this great session. It was really enriching, and I hope everyone really liked it. And thank you so much.
Thanks, Ankita. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Thanks, everyone. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye.